Welcome, everybody. Today is December 7th, 2021, and you're at the Army Corps of Engineers Industry Day for a design build construction lab at Washington State University. My name is Tiffany Scroggs. I'm with the Procurement Technical Assistance Center, known as PTAC, and I'll be your host and facilitator today with the team at the Army Corps. You are all muted. Please ask questions in the Q&A field. And this is being recorded and the slides will also be available after we're done today. But first, I do want to introduce a little bit more about PTAC program before we get too far into it. And the PTAC program is all across the country, and we are designed to help businesses win government contracts and subcontracts. Our services are offered at no cost because we're funded by the Department of Defense to provide this service. And so we help businesses find opportunities to bid. We help them find primes to bid to. We help you bid. We help you win and hopefully help you get paid. So anything that comes up along the journey of government contracting success, reach out to your PTAC program advisor and they can help you through that. In Washington State, we have a statewide program. I'm joined today with Jody O'Connor out of the Tri-Cities Program Office, and she'll be helping out on the chat today. You can find your local PTAC at the Association of PTAC website listed on the screen right now. It's aptac-us.org, and they can provide no-cost advising services to you as you succeed in the marketplace. So with that, let's go ahead and officially get going. I'm going to stop sharing my screen so that Rebekah can share her screen. Today's session is an Army Corps event that we're just happening to host, and we're delighted to partner with Army Corps Seattle to help them put on this event. Today, we're going to go through some formal slide deck. We have several representatives from Army Corps here today that Rebekah will help introduce, and then we'll do all the Q&A at the end. And we should be going a solid hour today, and so we'll try to get to all your questions. But if we have more questions than we have time for, the team at Army Corps has offered to help answer those after we're done today. So I will not be sharing an attendee list with all the other attendees. We didn't offer to do that today, but we certainly will try to get some networking happening in the chat. Feel free to introduce yourself that way and then put your questions in the Q&A. And that way we can make sure we keep those two things separate. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Rebekah Barker, who's going to share her screen and kick off the slide deck about this project over in Pullman, Washington. Rebekah Barker is the project manager on this. So Rebekah, take it away.
Thank you, Tiffany. And I want to thank PTAC for hosting us today. You know, this is an important event just to get the information out there, drum up interest, and also answer any questions about the project that might come up. See if there's any concerns within the industry or information that we can provide or should be paying attention to. So first I'm going to introduce the team here with the Army Corps of Engineers, and then I'll start sharing the slide deck and we'll get into that. So first I want to introduce John Solomon. John, if you wanna quickly just say who you are and what your role is.
Yeah, thank you for that. My name is John Solomon. I am the Small Business Deputy for the Seattle Department of Engineers. So any questions relative to small business, relative to prime or subcontracting, feel free to shoot me an email. My point of contact will be towards the end of this live presentation. So happy to help. Over.
Thank you, John. And then I'm going to introduce Bruce Okamura.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Bruce Okamura. I will be the contracting officer for this upcoming request for proposal. I'm also the current military environmental and interagency and international services branch chief here at Seattle District. Welcome aboard.
Thank you, Bruce. And last but not least, Debbie Knickerbocker.
Good morning, everyone. I'm the contract specialist on this project, which mainly means I do a lot of the grunt work to support the contracting officer, and I will help redirect certain questions and do a lot of the paperwork lifting, so to speak. Welcome, and I'm happy that we had such a good turnout.
Thank you, Debbie. So that's our team here at Seattle District. A lot of the communication First line communication will be with Debbie or John or myself, but also Bruce, of course. I'm going to start sharing my screen. And we'll get started with the presentation. So welcome. Thank you for attending today. This is, as has been introduced, a design-build construction contract that the Army Corps of Engineers intends to put out. We're calling it the ARSWSU Plant Biosciences Research Building. It'll be at Washington State University, the Pullman campus here in the state of Washington. ARS stands for the Agricultural Research Service, which is a part of the U.S. Department of Agriculture. They often partner with universities to build these research facilities for agricultural research. And then also Washington State University are partners in this endeavor, and this will be part of their campus. I've already done introductions of myself. I'm the project manager on this project, and Bruce Okamura will also be, towards the end of the slide deck, will be going over some of the more contractual details, I guess, for this. This project will be managed out of the Seattle District Corps of Engineers, and you can see everyone's little logos there at the bottom. Just a brief introduction to the Agricultural Research Service for those who have never worked with or heard of the ARS. As I said, they are part of the U.S. Department of Agriculture, and they're the chief scientific in-house research agency. Their job is to find solutions to agricultural problems. And one way is through partnering, which is on projects like this with universities. Washington State University, a little blurb about them. They do a significant amount of agricultural research. And as you can see, they have a long-standing history of joint research with the ARS, one of the strongest federal state partnerships in the nation. So we're excited to be a part of this. The ARS is funding this project, and they came to the Army Corps of Engineers to be the design and construction managing agent. So that is what the Corps of Engineers is doing here. Just briefly, I'll go into location. Not everyone maybe is from the West Coast, so a little geography lesson. It'll be in the state of Washington. And then if we zoom in there, Pullman is in the southeast corner. And you'll see Seattle over there and more of the north, more of the west. That's where Seattle District is. Washington State University, you can see here, right there in the city of Pullman. And there's a red box there. The site of this project will be really near the stadium. I've put a mark on the map here for Johnson Hall. That is an existing building at Washington State, and that is a building that is being demolished, and this project will be built on that site. This is a sort of an aerial view, so you can see on the left, you can see the stadium and their stadium way running right there. The white building right to the right side of stadium way, that's Vogel Hall. That will remain standing, and this new project going over top of where Johnson Hall is right now will be linked to that Vogel Hall building. So that is of particular note and a special requirement of this project. So this is a design build contract, design and construction services for a new plant biosciences research building. As I said, will be located at Washington State and located with what we're calling the Research Education Complex, which is a defined area at Washington State where they, part of a master plan, where there will be a number of research buildings. Vogel Hall is part of that. There are a number of offices, and there's also other buildings around there. So part of this project will be to, when you're siting the building, to maintain this sort of the campus feel and the connection with the sidewalks and the parking lots, so that there's access between all of these different buildings to foster that sort of collaborative research process. So the site will be on it's like a 1 to 2 acre site, will be developed with the supporting infrastructure that I've talked about, paved surfaces, lighting, landscaped areas, pretty typical of a project of this sort. And the building itself is rather large, right now authorized up to 113,000 square feet, gross square feet, and it will have research and office space. It'll be a mix of disciplines and programs. There will be approximately 320 researchers and students. Some of the folks that will be inhabiting this new facility currently have offices in Johnson Hall, and some folks currently have offices in Vogel Hall and will be moving over to the new facility. To go more into more detail of the scope, the building provides key connections within this research education complex, so it will have a direct connection to the Vogel Plant Sciences building that I pointed out. It will have a direct physical connection. And then the laboratories within will support various types of research. So there will be various configurations of laboratories, from micromolecular biology to plant and soil focused laboratories and everything in between or that might support those types of research. Research programs include hatch projects. And hatch projects have both ARS and WSC scientists. And each researcher focuses on a different part of a common research goal. So here, I've listed those here on the slide to give you an idea of the types of research and hence the types of labs that will be inside that building. And I'll just give you a minute to read through those. I mean, I guess I could read through them all, but so there's a number of these hatch projects and some additional special requirements and considerations. To design the laboratories using a laboratory typology approach, which utilizes a flexible and modular approach to allow space to change and adapt with the needs of the research groups over time. It's really important, especially at a university or any research institution, really. Funding doesn't come along every day, so it's important to build these facilities to stand the test of time and to maintain a flexible utility into the future as research needs change and research goals are adjusted. The adjacent Vogel Plant Sciences. So Vogel is to directly to the west, but there's also another building, Plant Sciences building. Let's see. So those buildings need to remain operational during construction. The Plant Sciences building, I hope I'm not mislabeling it. There are other buildings around there that shouldn't be disturbed. Vogel, of course, will have the direct physical connection and needs to remain operational also during construction with limited impact. So that is a special requirement. And then there are various goals outlined by ARS policy and procedure for sustainability. And so the goal for this project is to achieve a minimum LEED Silver certification. And there's also, this is in Washington, the state of Washington. I want to get that mixed up with Washington State, the university. But as a state institution, there are Washington Energy Executive Orders for state efficiency and environmental performance. So this is a federally funded project and a federally managed project. To the extent practical, we are also trying to follow the requisite local guidance and policy. Some other requirements as I move along. Some of these goals will seem that I've already talked about, but maybe that should emphasize their importance. Connectedness to the Vogel Plant Sciences Building, using a modular lab approach that can provide flexibility in the future, but also can provide some flexibility in our new sort of COVID-19 world, where they try to provide some separation while maintaining visual openness for the health of those in the labs, the scientists and the students. Flexibility within the labs to eliminate the need for significant renovations as needs change. Offices for those in Vogel who currently have offices in Johnson Hall. That's something that is being managed by Washington State and the ARS researchers, but is some coordination that will have to be done by the whoever is retained as the design build contractor as well. Part of that design is to make sure that those needs are met. There needs to be an appropriate area within the building for dirty soils processing. And also there needs to be thoughtful idea of the loading and delivering of material in concert with existing facilities. They're often very large deliveries for this project. So being thoughtful about the loading docks, traffic flow, both to the building, but also from the loading docks into the laboratories that most will use those materials, for instance, the soils labs. And with that said, we're going more into the details of the design build contract. So I'm going to turn this over to Bruce, and he will finish up this part of the briefing, and then we will go into the question and answer portion.
Thank you, Rebekah.
And Bruce, I'll continue to run the slide, so you can just ask me for the next slide.
Okay, thank you. We're on the verge of advertising this requirement. As you can see on the slide, this is a design build construction contract. Rebekah went over the basic requirement. As a design build contract, we have the current construction cost limitation of $89 million. Following the Corps of Engineers design build acquisition process, this will be a two-phase full and open solicitation with the selection based on a trade-off method under the best value process. The performance period is approximately 910 days, and we envision advertising this as early as January of 2022, which is just coming around the corner. As a design build, it will have a 35% design provided to get you started on the bidding process for the price. Okay, and I envision we'll be issuing the pre-solicitation notice of this very shortly. You're probably aware that we conducted a sources sought notice through SAM several weeks ago, and we also did a sources sought market research in regard to the use of a project labor agreement PLA under this contract, and we did get some responses. So thank you very much for those that responded. Next slide, please. So as for the requirement, the technical requirement, you will find that in the RFP that comes out. This requirement will also contain the recent DFARS clause that was implemented to ensure adequate COVID-19 safety protocols for federal contractors. Basically, what it does is it puts responsibility on the contractor to ensure that all workers under this contract have adequate protection and follow safety protocols when executing this requirement. And you can see some of the details under this website that's listed here. Okay. And then also, in the process of the solicitation, we will have, during phase two, when you have your site visit, there will be requirements that you must meet in regard to the safety protocols involving COVID-19 vaccination and testing documentation. Next slide, please. So on top of the federal requirements, you know, we are, unlike most requirements that the Corps of Engineers does, we are on a site where it comes under the Washington State requirements for COVID-19. So based on the Washington State Governor's Proclamation 2114, all contractors, subcontractors, personnel that will be working on this site will be required to meet the proclamation set forth by the governor of Washington, state of Washington. So, you know, we have no control over this. This is in effect right now. You know, as you all know, it may be a fluid situation where this requirement may change. So, you know, please be aware of the requirement that of the current Washington State requirements in regard to COVID-19. Okay. And Rebekah, I think that's what all I have to say for this meeting right now.
All right. I appreciate it, Bruce. So we'll go into the question and answer period. But I wanted to note as we go into that these slides and a summary of the questions and answers that we get at this point or within the next day will be provided at the SAM.gov site.
And Rebekah, also, there are two questions in the Q&A tab. The first question.
All right. Let's go ahead.
Yeah. First question, if everybody goes underneath along the on the bottom of your screen, there should be a Q&A tab. If you click on that, you'll see the question that I'm reading right now. The first question is, as a federal project, will Buy American be required? If so, which level? The Buy American Act will apply to this requirement. At this level, it could even be a trade agreement requirement. So on top, in addition to the Buy American, you'll probably be aware that this will be coming in or be advertised under the trade agreements. Okay. The second question, how heavy or light will the bridging documents be? Are you anticipating bridging docs at the SD or DD phase? Who is the bridging architect? Rebekah, I think this is more in your area.
Okay. So the bridging documents I can say who we've hired to do the bridging documents?
Are we talking about the 35% design in here? I'm not so sure.
Then I'm not sure either. Maybe we need some clarification on the question. Are we talking about, by bridging documents, are we talking about the RFP that we are currently preparing that we're going to put on the street? Or are we talking about documents that the architect that we, the design build contractor that we hire will be producing?
Uh, So I think Jeremy Erickson can offer some clarity on that in the Q&A, and then we can move on to Samantha's question about a proposed start date for construction.
The proposed construction, I mean, proposed start date for the construction will, wait, this is a design build requirement. So, you know, the design builder that gets the award will have to complete the design first before they actually break ground. As a contract itself, you know, we consider this to be a construction contract. So from my mind, construction commences the moment we execute the contract. If the question is about breaking ground, then, you know, the schedule will be on the design build contractor based on the 910 day calendar days of performance area that we're setting, you know, under this contract.
Great, thank you. And Jeremy was able to clarify his question that yes, he is talking about the 35% that you speak to in the slide.
Okay, so Rebekah, you know, I don't think we will be mentioning who actually created the 35% design at this point, but I'll defer to you in regard to how heavy or light the 35% design documents are.
I mean, I don't know if I can give how satisfactory an answer I can give. I mean, relative to other design build contracts I've had, I think the 35% design will be fairly robust as far as providing floor plans and sizing calculations and structural information and site surveys and geotechnical investigations have also taken place, so that information will be provided to whoever gets the contract. But also, it's going to be up to whoever gets the contract. Of course, all the design calculations and everything will have to be confirmed by the designer of record we bring on board, and it will be up to the various offerers how much of the design we provide that they want to use. And not that there's a ton of room to alter what we'll be providing, but because what we provide has been carefully designed to meet the requirements of not only the program of requirements document produced by the ARS and WSU and Corps of Engineers team together, but also just the specific requirements of the researchers or the laboratory. So I think it's pretty robust, but it's also not all set in stone. I don't know if that's a really good answer or not, but that's what I've got, or if you want to ask another question, of course, I can try to expand.
Okay, great. Thank you, Rebekah.
Thanks. Right, the next question.
Yeah, go ahead, Bruce. No, you got this. Go ahead.
Right. The next question is, will a list of Industry Day participants and contact information be distributed to participants to allow AEN teaming opportunities? I believe this will be available, correct, Tiffany?
Yeah, if everyone's okay with that, I was just typing a question to John Solomon. I think that's normal for you guys to post the list. At first I said no, but I think that'd be fine with us. We can provide it to you guys to post along with the SAM and on SAM with the video. And if anyone wants to opt out of being included, you can email me and we'll take you out, I guess. Does that sound good?
That's fine with me.
Okay.
All right. For step one, what are the expected selection factors to include? I'm not prepared to answer that yet. We are still going through the acquisition strategy and through the source selection plan. That's the last piece to complete before I could put this on the street. So, you know, when the RFP for phase one goes out, you know, you'll see it in there, and then it will be posted through SAN. Okay, the next question, can you tell us what the project experience requirements will be, specifically size, value, and recency of works? Again, as I answered the previous question, we're still in the works to finalize the criteria. So this will be listed in the RFP for phase one. Will a PLA be required? We're still reviewing all the input, but I think based on what I see right now that we will not be requiring a PLA. But let me caveat that statement by saying that anything I say won't be set in stone until the RFP comes out. How many contractors may pass phase one and move to phase two? Again, you know, we are finalizing the source selection plan, so I am not prepared to answer that, but it will be in the RFP. When do you anticipate awarding the contract? That is a very good question. It would depend on when, if we're able to advertise as scheduled, and then it would depend on the number and quality of the proposals that we receive. But I think we're looking to award the contract within, Rebekah, was it within the fiscal year or within the calendar year?
Within the fiscal year is our current plan.
Yeah. But that is our objective. And like I said, it's caveated by those things that I listed, meaning, you know, the more proposals we have, the longer it's going to take to evaluate. Will this be two-phase best value evaluation? How many to move in phase two? Also, teaming partner experience be accepted? Good question. It is two-phase because this is design build. As far as the number that it's going to be pared down to and whether subcontractor experience is going to be accepted, we are contemplating that and finalizing that in our source selection plan, and it will be stated in the RFP when it comes out. Can the list of firms who respond to the source sought be made available? At this point, I think we published the source. We haven't published the source sought, but typically it is. So when you respond as being interested in obtaining the solicitation, you'll be able to see that through SAM. Will Washington State University's role be during design build selection and during the project? What will be? Well, Rebekah, please correct me, but WSU is the owner of the site. Our direct customer is the Department of Agricultural Research Service. I'll defer to you on WSU's role, Rebekah.
Sure. They are the, we're building this at WSU. We've been coordinating with their facilities folks to make sure that and any design build contractor would also have to, in order to make sure that our building meets the requirements of Washington State University and also, I guess, their COVID requirements in line with the state of Washington's requirements for construction on their campus. They are also Washington State researchers are involved in informing the design requirements or have been involved as we develop the RFP. But moving forward, the Army Corps of Engineers will be providing, say, the construction oversight and managing the contract. It will be at Washington State, and I imagine that they'll have folks that attend meetings or, you know, hopefully I'm not going way outside the bounds of what you expect for the question answer. So we have researchers at Washington State will have some input when we are asking questions to finalize the design. They'll be reviewing the designs and offering comments. Washington State University's facilities folks have some role in making sure that our designs meet their requirements for the campus. But other than that, it's not their money on the line, as ARS is the ultimate deciding factor as far as meeting their requirements. And of course, all of those will be captured in the contract.
Thanks, Rebekah.
With Bruce having, with Bruce having the ultimate call on how the contract is administered.
Great answer. And I think the takeaway here is that the Corps of Engineers Seattle District has full agency on behalf of all the customers and stakeholders in regard to this requirement. That said, you know, we are the single face to the industry, and, you know, any contact or any communication during the project, you know, will be done through our duly appointed representatives in the contracting officer or the administrative contracting officer, you know, or the project engineer or project manager and the COR. Okay. So, you know, this is pretty basic. When you contract with the government, you know, you don't have a direct privity with our customers. You know, you have all your directions through the Army Corps of Engineers. Okay, and this next question, I think we answered, who will be representing WSU on the project. The only exception with WSU, you know, they're the owner of the facility and the site. So you know, you do have in the contract, you know, the requirements for permits and responsibilities as the prime or the awardee of the contract. You know, any permissions, licenses, or requirements that's being placed from the site, you know, you will be responsible for obtaining that, you know, from WSU. I think that would be the direct relation that the contractor will have, Bruce, with WSU.
Bruce, I want to make a small caveat to that. Washington State owns the land, ARS owns the building, and they'll have a lease agreement.
Okay, so then.
But other than that, what you said about that local permits, construction permits, and everything still.
So that's another twist that ARS, as the lessor, and they control probably the facility, you know, any ingress or passing requirements or physical security that's required by ARS on their facilities while they're working there, and, you know, we're getting into their work site. You know, that contractor will have to work directly with them to obtain the proper permissions and access, you know, for that. Okay. Is the team that designed the 35% design documents precluded from competing for this design build contract? Uh, I'm not prepared to answer that yet because I think we are still looking into that. Will stipends be provided to the unsuccessful teams that are invited to submit design build proposals during the RFP phase? There will be no stipends under this contract. Can you discuss what the diverse business enterprise goals or requirements will be for the project? If we're talking about the small business subcontracting goals, it depends on the acquisition strategy that we will finalize and place on this contract. But for instance, if it does go unrestricted, we will have the small business goal objectives that the unrestricted prime will have to meet or achieve in their subcontracting plan. John Solomon, would you like to add anything to that?
No, I mean, yeah, that's pretty much it. You know, we conducted market research on this, if any anticipation it's going to go full and open. And so we got an industry feedback on the expectations of percentages, goals subject to the clause that will be incorporated in the eventual solicitation. And so those numbers will be provided. And if there's any issues with that, during the solicitation phase, that would be the appropriate means to kind of raise those questions to the agency. Over.
Thank you, John. What are the primary stakeholders involved, and will this include USDA? Rebekah, if I miss anybody, please add. You know, we do have the Department of Agriculture. We have Washington State University. You have the Army Corps of Engineers. Are there any other stakeholders or parties of interest that's involved here?
I can't think of any major ones that we've been coordinating with.
That's okay.
Pretty good list.
Thank you. Are there small business utilization goals? I think we've answered that in the previous question, that it depends on the acquisition strategy that we will decide on. But if it does go unrestricted, there will be small business subcontracting goals that would be in the RFP. What role will WSU staff play in team selection? Like I said before, the Corps of Engineers have full agency authority on this, and the selection will be made under my guidance within the Army Corps of Engineers. And as far as any makeup on who is on the selection, that is protected information as being procurement sensitive, and I will not disclose that. How will this solicitation be solicited? Full and open, small business 8A? I think we've answered that in several questions. This is full and open. Two-phase design build acquisition strategy in regard to any set-asides or whether it's going to be unrestricted, that is being contemplated right now and finalized under the RFP. Please clarify best value trade-off. Will all technical factor when combined be considered less than equal to or more important than price? Best value trade-off is when we will ask for technical proposals on technical criteria or experience from each offeror. And we will evaluate those technical proposals on its merit against what we've asked for. And trade-off means that we have the ability to select the more technically superior proposal over price, so long as that price differential is worth the technical superiority. So that said, I would say, and you know, I caveat this with my statement that I made earlier, that anything I say just won't, you know, be finalized unless, you know, until you see the final RFP that's issued on the street. But like most trade-offs, the technical factors combined will be more important than price. Can you tell us who will be the USAID's quality assurance rep on this site? Pullman is not an area that we normally have contracts. As you're aware, you know, the Corps of Engineers Seattle District, we work mostly on our civil works and military projects. So this is sort of out of our way, but we're prepared to set up contract administration capabilities, you know, on the site. At this point, I'm not prepared to say who those personnel are. Is LEED certification part of this contract, and what level of certification will be the project be seeking? The answer is yes, and Rebekah, I defer to you as for the level of certification.
Yes, LEED Silver.
Okay. And you'll see in the RFP, you know, which organizations will be accepting the certifications from. Correct, Rebekah?
That is correct.
Okay. With the bridging architect be part of the selection committee, and will they be precluded from submitting on this project? I think we touched on that earlier. I'm not prepared to say who the 35% designer is, and I'm not prepared to divulge the makeup of the selection team. Due to the project being federally funded, will this project follow DoD unified facility criteria? I believe the answer is yes. Rebekah, please elaborate if necessary.
That is correct. With also the caveat, we are following the UFCs, but there are some ARS requirements that there may be a few additional on top of the UFCs that are just specific to what the ARS requires.
Okay, great. Thank you. And the last question that we have in the Q&A, does the project scope include high containment space requirements, i.e. BSL-2, BSL-3, et cetera? Rebekah, I think this is a technical question in your area.
It is a technical question. I may not have the answer to off the top of my head, but I can try to find the answer to that and we can post that.
Yeah, or else, I mean, you know, this is something
or
that...
Or it'll be in the RFP.
Right. I mean, you know, look for it in the RFP. As you all are aware, you know, we have a process to ask questions through ProjNet once the RFP goes out. So, you know, we're not really prepared to really go into the detail because, you know, we're still in the process of finalizing the RFP. One more question. Will compliance with ARS 242.1 be required? I am not familiar with ARS 242.1.
I don't know specifically about that one, but as I noted a couple questions ago, there are some ARS requirements that will be included in the RFP in addition to the UFC.
Okay. That's another question. Will this procurement include a price evaluation preference for hub zone small business? Again, we're finalizing the acquisition strategy and the selection criteria right now. So look for that in the RFP.
Very good. That was pretty impressive there, Bruce. You got through all the questions with 10 minutes to spare. I want to thank the Army Corps team. Any other parting thoughts or any last messages you want to send out there, Bruce or Rebekah or John or Debbie?
There's
a recommendation, maximum of 3 shortlisted for phase 2 RFP. Will the USACE follow this? This is something that we're figuring out right now, and it will be stated in the RFP. Thank you, everybody, for participating in this. We try to be as open and transparent about the requirement as we can. A lot of things, some of our answers were vague, but they were vague simply because we're still in the process of figuring that out, and I did not want to stray you to the wrong direction. And if you're interested, download the RFP when it comes out, read it thoroughly. Don't just focus on the technical requirements, but focus on the front end so that you prepare your proposals properly in accordance with the way the government is asking you to, put your package together. And like I said, if you have any questions, there's a method for asking questions through ProjNet, and the ProjNet key and the site, it will be listed in the RFP. One last thing, it's not about Pullman, but a little bit of a preview that we have another requirement coming downstream at Oregon State University in Corvallis, Oregon. It won't be as large in magnitude as this requirement in Pullman, but be on the lookout for this next requirement. It's a smaller requirement for Oregon State University in Corvallis, Oregon. And Rebekah, you might want to just sort of put a little tidbit on what that requirement entails. Thank you.
Oh, sure. So thank you, Bruce. The ARIS project coming up in Corvallis, as Bruce has said, is a smaller requirement versus a large sort of office building type laboratory research facility. It is instead going to be a series of screen and greenhouses for agricultural research. So I maybe also like some sort of administrative building. I don't know all the details on that, but definitely look for that coming up, as Bruce said. Other than that, I've displayed my final slide that gives you a point of contact for additional questions. As we noted for this presentation, we would be posting questions and answers on SAM.gov after this industry day concludes. So we wanted to leave that sort of window for questions that might occur to you open until the end of the day tomorrow. And so I put a point of contact up for you or for questions in the future. I can't guarantee any questions that come in after tomorrow, though, that we will provide answers at this time. As Bruce had said, there's a process for when we issue the RFP for putting in questions about the RFP through the ProjNet system. But right now for the industry day, we're just trying to gather everything so everyone can see, and also a recording of this whole sort of industry day presentation will be posted online. So you can see our sometimes specific and sometimes vague answers to those questions that you've asked. So I've posted John Solomon's point of contact as our Small Business Programs deputy here at Seattle District. If you have specific small business questions, I expect you can address him anytime on those. But acquisition related project specific questions, you can send to our contracting specialist, Debbie Knickerbocker, and she will help field those. And if she needs additional technical input, can bring them to my attention or other members of our team. So with that said, I don't have anything additional, but I really thank everyone for their interest.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much, Rebekah, Bruce, Debbie, and John, for holding today's Industry Day. All the information will be available on your SAM posting once you get that updated, and we'll send you over the link to the recording as soon as that gets processed today. So thank you everyone for coming. Reach out to your local PTAC. We're no-cost services to help you succeed in government contracting.